And there's video. Can you see me?
I can see you.
Yeah, this is a different hotel. You got this background over here.
Nice. Okay. Background.
Yeah, this is a weird layout for this room, but I do have the TV there, so I got the OKC Thunder game playing in the background, but muted.
All right. You got the lava lamps?
Uh-oh. I should have those. That's a thing I should have.
Sure.
I noticed that this is getting too long.
On you?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, looks good.
All right. But we'll get going. So today is class 6, Thursday the 12th. We're going to talk about... Rob, I assume. Right?
Oh, you were cutting out, so say that again.
The quiz. I didn't get it to you.
That is correct. I do not have it.
Okay. I'll get that when I get back to the office. It's actually on a removable hard drive at the office. So, and I'm not at the office, so I didn't get that out. But what I did do is I added some quiz questions to today's presentation, so we can go over that. I do encourage anybody who feels bold enough to, you know, give us or give me privately, if you want to, the answer to the quiz. I think I have 12-ish questions or something added to the slides. So we'll go through that. Tuesday was a lot. We went through all of encryption. Tonight we're going to go through physical security. We might get to a little bit of the technical security. I feel pretty confident that we'll be able to get through, you know, all of the technical things in for sure two classes. So this one kind of went, this domain went into, you know, obviously three classes, but I'm pretty positive we can get the technical domain. I call it the technical domain because I can't remember the exact name for it, but it's network security and what have you. We'll get through that in two classes. I'm really, really confident of that. And then we'll try to get back on track. So this is kind of what we covered on Tuesday. We went through the virtualization, distributed computing, went through some system vulnerabilities, threats, and countermeasures. Then we really dug in and spent most of our time with encryption and cryptography. The history part was kind of my favorite part. That was, I think, pretty fun. And then we talked about the types of cryptography, three types that we have, symmetric, asymmetric, and hashing. Talked about a little bit, some cryptographic attacks. I think we covered maybe one or two that weren't even in the book. Then we talked about just cryptography implementation or encryption implementation. So let's get on to some quiz stuff. So the first one, Julius Caesar constructed his own encryption method to hide data during transmission or while being stored. The Caesar cipher works in which of the following ways? A, each letter in the alphabet is replaced with a letter three places beyond it. Letters are randomly scrambled. The message itself consists of clues to recover from different places in the physical world. Replaces letters in the alphabet using 13 characters beyond it. A lot of A's, so that is the right answer. Sorry, A. And then I did give a little bit of an explanation. So when you get the notes, you'll have the explanation too. So number two, PKI and PGP can provide similar functionality, but a PKI provides an actual framework for an environment to work within. They also use different trust structures. Which of the following best describes PGP's trust structure? Certificate authorities, web of trust, PACS, or hierarchical? So this is PGP. Remember, Phil Zimmerman created that, and it's based on the web of trust. So B is the right answer. Pretty good privacy. Number three, secure sockets layer is the most common protocol that's used for securing internet transactions. Which of the following is not a characteristic of SSL? Minimize that. Originally developed by Netscape, that's a true statement. Protects both the message and communication channel over the internet via VPN service. SSL doesn't in this sense is not necessarily a VPN, but let's get the other questions. Provides encryption, message integrity, and server authentication. That's true. Uses public key encryption. So the best answer, even though it's not fully, I think, a true answer would be B. You can have SSL VPNs, but that's the least correct. Most correct, least not correct. Anyway, you get it, it's B. But I clicked away from it, there we go. And a little information about SSL. So this one I thought was kind of fun because we didn't talk about it. And I don't think it'll get this detailed on the test, but it's kind of neat. In a 64-bit data encryption algorithm key, how many bits make up the true key? How many bits make up parity? 16 plus 48 for parity, 48 plus 16 for parity, 64 and no parity, 56 plus 8 for parity. So if you remember, I was talking about it. I mentioned during the class on Tuesday that DES and DEA, which is built off of DEA, which is actually built off of Lucifer from IBM, is a 56-bit key. I didn't mention anything about 8 bits for parity, but there, it's a 56-bit key, so the right answer here is D. Yeah, then remember the four operating modes are important for the test. Actually, 5, CBC, CFB. We don't have counter mode there. So there's actually 5 distinct modes. So electronic code book, cipher block chaining, cipher feedback, and output feedback, and then counter mode is another mode that I didn't mention here. Feedbacks, if you remember, that means streaming. Chaining is in block mode. So we have block mode and streaming mode, I don't know if you recall. And then electronic code book actually has nothing that feeds into the next block of ciphertext. So counter mode uses that nonce and then the counter. Which is not true of the advanced encryption standard. It was developed to replace DES. It uses key sizes of 64, 128, and 192. It is a block symmetric cipher. It uses the algorithm Rindell. I always call it Rindell because I never get it right. Rindell, I think is how you're supposed to say it. So it is built to replace DES. B, it does not use 64, 128, and 192. It uses 128, 192, and 256. So B is the wrong answer because it is a block cipher and it is using the Rindell. So B is the right answer. Questions? Nothing? Okay. Mathematics. The more complex the mathematics are, the more resources that are required for computation. Which asymmetric algorithm is the most efficient, requiring the fewest resources? So RSA, ECC, Blowfish. IDEA is asymmetric. If you remember, IDEA was the patent. The patented symmetric algorithm, so you can automatically cross that one off the list. And remember the elliptic curve cryptography, ECC is used for low processing power type applications, and is the right answer. Which is the 128-bit algorithm that was accepted for the DES standard? This one is kind of a trick question. We'll see how you guys do. A, skipjack. That's not right. That's an 80-bit encryption. It was used by the government for prying on things. B, data encryption algorithm. C, Lucifer. Or D, RSA. Many people think it's B, the data encryption algorithm. How many people think it's C, Lucifer? It's definitely not RSA. Right answer here is actually Lucifer. Lucifer is 28-bit algorithm, and DEA is actually 64-bit. So a little bit of a... They were both kind of built or accepted as the DES standard, sort of, but the key here is Lucifer is 128-bit and data encryption algorithm is 64. So that's kind of a trick question. If you brought it down to B or C, you're probably good. I doubt you'd get trick questions like that in the exam. Which of the following is not true of RSA? Was accepted as the new advanced encryption standard in the late 1990s, can be used for encryption and digital signatures, can be used for key exchange, developed at MIT by Ron Rivest, Eddie Shamir, and Leonard Adelman. It was not accepted as the advanced encryption standard in the late 1990s. That's the Reindahl. So A is the right answer. Yeah. All right then. Which of the following algorithms was not considered by NIST when determining the algorithm that was to be used for the new AES in 1997? Twofish, Mars, Reindahl, and El Gamal. Mars was, Reindahl also was. El Gamal is a symmetric encryption algorithm that was not asymmetric, sorry. An attacker who has access to a large section of ciphertext then determines which part of it is to be decrypted and ultimately has access to the resulting plain text has performed what type of attack? Chosen ciphertext, known plain text, chosen plain text, or ciphertext only? Ciphertext only is not a type of attack, so D is not correct. So is this going to be chosen ciphertext, known plaintext, or chosen plaintext? We had a large amount of ciphertext, and he determines which part. So he's going to choose his ciphertext. That answer would be A. So it's a chosen ciphertext attack. In 1976, Diffie and Hellman introduced what cryptography technology? Electronic key distribution, digital signatures, symmetric key encryption, 256-bit key encryption capabilities. Yes, stopped answering. Well, there we go. Nailed it. I got a private answer. The answer is A. That was really the sole purpose at the beginning for Diffie-Hellman. A secret key that is used for data encryption only one time is called A, public key, asymmetric key, key exchange, or session key. The right answer here is D. Be a session key used for the duration of the session. Sometimes it gets regenerated, or you generate a new one, even during a session if the session is long enough. Which key knows the trapdoor? So I didn't mention, I don't think, anything on Tuesday about trapdoors, but which key knows the trapdoor that allows decryption to take place? So the trapdoor is in discrete logarithms and in the factoring large prime numbers, so those are both asymmetric methods. The trapdoor allows you to do it backwards. So we have the public key and the private key. When we talk about asymmetric encryption, the private key is actually the trapdoor. So C is the correct answer. A fixed length value used as a message fingerprint is called a MAC, message authentication code, hash value, message value, or digital signature. Right answer here is hash value. There, quiz done. Everybody got all right, I assume. So I still will send as soon as I get back to the office. I'll be back at the office on Friday, sometime tomorrow late. I'll send the quiz that I talked about on Tuesday. I meant to do that, but then I had to leave to get here for this project. So I didn't get that. I forgot to take that and put that on my computer. But I'll also get the physical security ones to you by then too. Okay, so here, these are just some interesting, these are all kind of around the same story. I think it's sort of interesting. So the whole, kind of coming out of the whole Apple sort of resisting, refusing to decrypt the terrorist iPhone from California. From that came a law that Feinstein and Burr wrote, and there's a lot of backlash about it. And it's pretty interesting. So these are some interesting news stories. I'd be floored if this bill goes through without some, you know, really major changes. But essentially, what the bill requires, or what its intent is for vendors to build backdoors into their encryption, so that given a court order, the manufacturer or the vendor would have to decrypt the data. So that opens up all kinds of unintended consequences potentially. So these are just some good stories around that. I think the one from the Register, this one, is a really good story. It's got some interesting quotes by Bruce Schneier, which I think are kind of, he's the one that actually called it brain dead. So it's pretty cool. Good stuff to read and how it applies today. So we're done with encryption. Other than, I'm going to give you that quiz as soon as I get back to the office. I'll send that to Rob so he can get that out to everybody. Now we're going to talk about physical security. Physical security is kind of fun. It's probably the easiest domain to relate to because we have, it's the stuff that you can see typically. It's the stuff that you can touch. So it's pretty easy to relate to. Now on the assessment side of things, so when we're doing risk assessments, administrative controls is kind of sort of easy to assess. I think technical controls are probably the easiest to assess. Physical controls, even though they're the easiest to relate to, it really seems like they're the most difficult to assess for a number of reasons. I think there's so many factors that go into really determining the likelihood of something bad happening, the impact if it did, around physical security, because you have to take into account the crime rate for the area that you're operating in. You need to take into account things like natural disasters for the area that you're talking about. You also need to take into consideration the data that you need to protect. What I've been doing here in Rochester is I'm working with the city of Rochester. I worked at City Hall. I did four physical security assessments last week. Today, part of my day was to do a physical security assessment of the library, the public library. Totally different sites, same crime rate, in both areas. The natural disasters are essentially the same, but the city has much different information. The four sites, anyway, have much different information than the library. The library really has patron information, so it's a much different dynamic. So I wouldn't expect the same physical controls to protect the data at the library as I would at City Hall. I'll go through some of these things, and I'll try to share, some stories. Like I said before, one of the things that I do is social engineering attacks, and sometimes those are physical social engineering attacks. So I'll try to remember some stories as we're going through this of some real attacks that I've done or been a part of. Yeah, it should be fun. So we have, all I intend to do tonight is just get through physical security. I'm not going to try to dive, go too far or too hard and get into the network stuff tonight. I just feel like we need to make sure we get these things down. So some unique terms, man trap. So a man trap really is, it's meant to trap a man. So it's two doors. Usually one door would open. I would enter. So I'm entering into the man trap. The other door is closed. That door behind me needs to close before I can activate the other door. And typically there's two types of access control on the doors. We'll talk about, we'll get more in detail on that. Bollards are, we see them all the time, usually in front of like gas stations or convenience stores. Usually when they put them there, it's meant to stop the vehicle, old people. I should take that back. Not necessarily just old people. People sometimes mistake the gas for the brake. We've seen probably YouTube videos or things where cars have crashed through storefronts. Bollards are meant to prevent that. You also see bollards at government buildings, and they're meant to stop a bomb-laden vehicle from getting to the building. So bollards are kind of meant to stop cars. Smart cards. The big distinguishing feature in a smart card is that it has some logic built into it. So you see, nowadays we have chip and pin, and you've got that little a chip on it. That's an integrated circuit. That's a smart card. So now our Visa cards used to be just swipe, magnetic swipe cards. Now they're smart cards. They've got the chip on it. Contact. We'll talk about that stuff too. And then tailgating. Tailgating is walking. It's really easy to gain access to a lot of buildings through tailgating. Essentially, somebody authenticates, opens the door, and you go in behind them. So you didn't have to actually badge in or authenticate the facility. So there are some unique terms, and we're going to go more into that. So physical assets, people, buildings, systems, data. One of the things that you'll see on the exam, because there really are big sticklers, ISC squared always has been about human safety. So human safety always trumps everything else, trumps any kind of physical control. So if you're given a scenario and it's human safety versus protecting your most significant information assets, choose the human safety one. Protect against unauthorized access, disasters, man-made, and natural. So physical security, I always think of physical security as being the things that I can touch and see. So starting at the perimeter, now when I do assessments, I either start at the perimeter and work my way in, or I start at your most significant, most critical physical location and then work my way out. And what I'm looking for is layers of defense. So if you've got a data center, we can start at the data center or start at the server room. And then what other physical, maybe you've got your server room inside of an office space, and you've got access control around the server room, you've got access control around the office space. And maybe the third layer is you've got access control around the perimeter. Ideally, we want to stop attackers, at the perimeter. If they're just roaming around, that could be a problem. So help prevent, detect, and correct unauthorized physical access. Defense in depth is that layered approach to physical security. In a perimeter defense posture, I might have additional layers on the perimeter. I might have a fence with a gate. I might have bollards. I might have a number of things before you even get to the actual front door. Those are all things on the outside of the building. Fences, ranging from deterrence, so those small fences that just kind of keep people from, you can easily jump them, but they kind of keep people just honest, I guess, all the way up to real preventative type fences where they might be eight feet or higher. And we don't really talk about in the exam too much about walls, but walls are also, those, they serve that same kind of purpose. Sometimes we have barbed wire or razor wire on the top, whatever. Different types of fences, but really the purpose of defenses and walls is to steer people to a controlled point, steer people to either a door or a gate. It's not so much to prevent people from going over. I mean, that's important, but really the purpose is to bring them to a spot where I can control access better, and that's the purpose for fences. Gates, different types of gates. These four classes of gates you'll probably need to memorize for the exam. Class one is, home use, very easy to bypass, all the way up to, restricted access. Class four gates, which might be those ones, I don't know if you rent cars, but in some airports, when you go to the car rental, they have this gate that comes up out of the ground, and really if you're gonna try to run that, it's not gonna happen. That would be a class four gate, but class one, two, three, and four, ranging from just decorative ornamental to, stopping a car. And then I give the specification there if you want to know more about gates. that's a bad gate. I did pull some kind of bad, you know, funny, I thought, bad examples. That's a fail. So there's a gate without a fence, or maybe it's a fence without a gate. I don't even know if you can open that thing. Bollards. So a traffic bollard, strong post usually, and there's specifications for how deep bollards should be, what materials they should be made out of. You don't have to remember any of that stuff for the exam. Really the purpose for bollards is just to restrict vehicle access, keep vehicles away from things. A lot of times we see them at convenience stores to stop people from running through the store. Secure facilities, we want to maybe keep people away from an exterior wall. Sometimes, depending on what type of facility it is and what we're doing in the facility, like government buildings historically have been targets for domestic or international terrorism. So those bollards would be built differently and be placed in different locations. In downtown Minneapolis, I don't know if you've seen the government courthouse, the new one, where they've got, they're actually using landscaping and planters as bollards to prevent vehicles. So that's another thing that you could do, is you could create berms around the building to stop cars from running into stuff. What's wrong with this picture? This is a picture from an actual assessment that we did. This one's kind of a big deal. Yeah, boom. So this is, there's a couple of things that are wrong here. One, the bollards are too far spaced for the transformer. So it'd be pretty easy to run into that transformer. I'm not sure those bollards are really going to be strong enough to really do much. Then you have the propane tank, which has no bollard whatsoever. And then you've got ice on the ground. So you're kind of lucky that this place hasn't gone up in flames. So this is an example of one of the things that we would certainly point out when we're doing a physical security assessment, and then make recommendations to not kill yourself. Lights. Lights are both a detective and deterrent control. So bringing it back to kind of the basics that we talked about before, remember we have administrative, physical, and technical controls, and then we have preventative, detective, corrective, deterrent, those types of controls. So lights would be a detective physical control or a deterrent physical control. So in the exam, you'll need to put those things together. So lights, detective, or deterrent controls. It's not uncommon for us to, when we do a physical assessment, to go check things out at night just to see how good or bad things are. As examples, big hospital in large hospital in Iowa that backed up to a park, had a lot of lights at the at the front, kind of for safety purposes. The parking lot was well lit in the front, but in the back there were no lights. So there were some problems, because it'd be easy to attack this facility or do things bad from the backside, because there's no lights in the park and there's no lights the back of the hospital, and a lot of nooks and crannies. I don't know if you've been around many hospitals on the outside, but typically there's a lot of nooks and crannies, and there's usually some pretty sensitive things on the outside, like oxygen tanks and other stuff. So detective and deterrent control, the criminals will gravitate towards poorly lit areas over visible ones. Illuminate enough for field of vision for the area that's going to be protected, especially if you're going to have camera surveillance. I've seen a lot of times where you've had camera surveillance that wasn't infrared, so it had no ability to see in really low light areas, and there wasn't any light, so you never got any camera surveillance at night. Fresnel, for some reason, this has been a standard thing that's been in CISSP books from the very beginning, and it still seems like it's there today. This type of light, and you've seen it before on lighthouses. It's kind of the concentric circles that move light in a specific direction. So for some reason, it's still there. Fresnel lenses are what they're talking about. Light measurement, you'll need to know how you measure light. So lumen is how much light one candle creates. Foot candles is how many lumens per square foot. And then lux is on the metric system. So one lux is a lumen per square meter. That's how you would measure light. Not that you're probably going to do it much. Closed circuit TV. We like closed circuit TV. This is also a detective and a deterrent control. So sometimes people notice the little domes or the cameras that are placed throughout the exterior facility. So a best practice for camera surveillance is to have the building approaches covered by camera surveillance and have all entrances and exits covered, and to have all activities in and around sensitive areas covered. So it is a best practice to have a camera, you know, in the data center or in the server room, as well as outside, so that you can catch people that are coming and going. So TV, many different types of closed circuit television cameras. One of the things we often, sometimes not often, but we see occasionally is poorly secured NVR systems. So the network video recording system is not really secured. So sometimes we've seen it actually in the same spot as some of the cameras. So if I were an attacker and I was going to disable the camera, the NVR system is, you know, in a cabinet really close. So that's a poor design. Infrared devices can see in the dark, displaying heat. Older tube cameras are analog devices, usually really, really poor quality. Image quality is really important. And camera systems, depending on what the purpose of the camera system is. So having a camera system on the exterior, you know, maybe pointing at the parking lot, if it's not high enough quality to see, you know, things like license plates, then it's probably not a high enough quality camera. Digital watchdog, yep. Yeah, there's so many makers of cameras. And it's not, I mean, even the cameras you get at Costco now, you know, you can buy one of those packs of like, I don't know, 6, 7, whatever cameras. Even that, those cameras, better than nothing. They're pretty, actually pretty good quality. Mechanical irises that act like human irises, so that's what changes the amount of light that comes into the aperture, in and out. And then the lens changes, you know, the focus. Key issues, field of depth and field of view. So the field of depth is what areas in focus, and the field of view is what's covered by the camera. It really comes down to quality. We've seen a lot of camera systems too that can't even identify. I mean, people look like blobs on the camera system. So when you go to, very few people monitor cameras actively. Instead, what they use them for detective controls where something bad happens, I go back to the camera surveillance and try to build some kind of investigation or case. It sucks when the camera quality isn't good enough. It also stinks when you don't have enough storage. So storage is a big issue with camera surveillance. It's, you know, 90 days or more is a good amount for camera. Pan, tilt, zoom. It's up, down, back and forth. So panning is back and forth, tilting is up and down, and then the zoom piece is, you know, can I zoom in on things? Pan, tilt, zoom most often is used for cameras that are being actively monitored. Fixed camera view, just staying there. Oh, so these are the displays. So these are kind of fun when you go to guard desks and kind of see, or you go to at some organizations, they'll have a command center where they have the cameras, like the city, for instance, has, I don't know, 300 cameras throughout the city. And so they have this command center, and it's actually pretty cool. They would be using multiplexing and auto scanning. So they're using those together. So they'll show, multiplexing is showing multiple images on one screen. Then auto scanning is when it kind of jumps from one camera to another. And then the fixed view is just the old school, just one camera, one view, and that's it. So those are the different types of displays that, you know, I think the basic different types of displays that, that you can employ with closed circuit television. Magnetic tapes such as VHS, backup images from tube cameras. Those are obviously really, really old. I don't know, you know, where you can get VHS tapes anymore. CCD cameras for DVR and NVR. So digital video recorder, a network video recorder. There are so many different options. These are just the basics about closed circuit television. Some of them are IP-based, some of them are motion detection, so they only start recording if it detects motion. That reduces the amount of storage that you need. Those are all. But this is the basics. These are the basics that you really need to know for the exam. It can get very, very sophisticated quickly on cameras. That's a bad design. Right? Get the camera sitting there. Just unplug the power. Pretty easy to disable. Not just that, but if I knew that that camera was there, it'd be pretty easy just to reach around without ever coming into the camera view to disable that camera. And that's a poor design, too. These are just Googled. I think they're funny. We see stuff like this pretty often, sort of. Physical locks, preventative physical control. We don't like key locks very much. We don't like key locks and we don't like pin pad locks because key locks, it's really hard. Most organizations do a really poor job of managing keys. Keys are really easy to duplicate, even when they say do not duplicate on them. You distribute keys, people forget to bring them back. People may, you know, could easily make a copy of the key and then bring back the key, check in, check out process. I mean, there's so many issues with physical locks. Somebody could leave the organization, a disgruntled employee. We also don't have any accountability when people are using physical keys. You know, it's not like a badge access where there's a log somewhere. So we're not a big fan, you know, as security people of physical key locks. Preventative physical control used on doors and windows to prevent unauthorized physical access. Maybe mechanical, such as key locks or combination locks, or electronic with smart cards or mag stripe cards. Those are the kind of locks we like, usually. So key locks, physical key, we've all seen them, we all use them, can be shared, copied, lowers accountability of key locks. We don't know when somebody entered or when somebody left. Sometimes we might have a contact on the door, so we know that somebody entered. But you can see kind of the defense in depth thing too. So a compensating control, if I didn't want to invest in a key card access system and I'm still gonna stick with my camera lock thing, maybe I put a door contact, so at least I have a log of every time that door opens. And maybe I tie that into a camera surveillance system, so every time that door opens, a picture gets snapped or something. You know, we get some kind of mitigating control for not having the accountability of the key lock. Common type pin tumbler lock, that's our pins, drivers, so they have to line up with the shear line, and once they line up with the shear line, then you can turn them. All physical key locks can be picked, just a matter of time and skill. Other things about locks, I don't know if you've ever seen on locks, sometimes you see the number, that's actually the combination, that's the number to create a new key. So even if I was an attacker and I didn't have physical access to the key, maybe I snap a picture of a physical key that somebody else has or somebody else left laying around, and then I just go to the hardware store and have them make one. That'll work. Warded locks are the ones, you know, instead of having, you know, where the pins have to line up with the shear line, the warded lock instead has grooves or notches that are built into the lock, so the key has to have the right notches so that it will go through those notches when you turn it. Using the wrong key, misaligned pins, jamming the lock plug, it won't turn. Warded and ward locks, like I mentioned, it's kind of that second picture with the yellow lock. Using the skeleton key, we've kind of seen those before. The spring bolt lock is, you see those on all the residential doors. Most doors have that. And so it just, when you close the door, what's the word I'm looking for? And when you close the door, it hits the door jamb and then springs out and then springs back into the jamb. That's the spring bolt lock. deadbolt is the rigid one. So if you look at the two locks on the door there, the one on the bottom is the spring bolt lock, and the one on the top is the deadbolt. They both extend into the strike plate and the door jamb. That's how those all work. Exciting stuff. Lock picking. All doors, I mean, all physical locks can be picked. We have, or had people, I think we still have people at FRSecure who pick locks. It's the art of picking a lock without a key. So you use the tension wrench and you use a pick just to, and what you're trying to do is just line up those pins with a shear line so that you can turn the tumbler. Lift pins, slip tacker. Bumping is another thing that you can do. So bumping is trying to get the, so at the same time that you're hitting the lock, you're turning the plug, and the point is, if I bump it, that the pins will jump and that they'll fall at the same time I'm turning, so they'll fall into the shear line, and then I can turn the lock. So not a really good preventative control, because they are. Now you'll see fire codes too. When we get to, I tell you now, it's one of the things we always have to take into account when we're talking about physical security is the fire codes, or building codes. So in some places, in most places actually, you may have a key card access door, but it also has a physical lock. So the physical lock is never actually used, but it is a bypass to the key card access. So when we have instances like that, as a mitigating control, what we want is some type of an alarm or some type of an alert to be generated anytime the door is opened without a key card access. Because that means either somebody broke through the door or somebody used the key, and we want to make sure that, you know, that's something that should be investigated. Other types of keys, the master keys and the core keys. You can see on the right, the picture on the right, that's a core key. So it's pulling out the lock core. If you're going to recore the keys, recore the locks, you would recore the locks. It's a good practice to recore the locks every so often to refresh keys, but it's kind of an expensive process. But if I've lost, you know, let's say I've lost a master key, and I can't account for it. Your only good choice for making things right would be to recore the lock so that the master key doesn't work anymore. So that can be really expensive. So master keys open any lock for a given security zone in a building. In some cases, there are master keys that open every security zone in the building. Access to the master key obviously should be tightly controlled. If you've done locking well or designed it well, you would have multiple zones, and you'd have to check out master keys. So even maintenance would have to check out master keys and then bring those back. And the purpose of the zones is having some better accountability of who's accessing. Core keys, remove that lock core, interchangeable core locks, which would be essentially rekeying the facility or the lock. If you take the core out, really all you need is a screwdriver to open the door, usually. Combination locks are bad things to, usually. Not a very good preventative control because they're pretty easily defeated. In the traditional sense, they have dials that can be turned to specific numbers in specific order. So we've all seen those when we were in high school. We all had those clocks, or maybe at the gym. Weak form of physical access control for production environments. I can't even imagine it would be a bad thing to see your data center being locked by a combination lock. But we also have button or keypad locks used for numeric combinations. Those are pretty easy to bypass usually too, because people don't change the codes very often. So if one thing, they're usually shared codes. So that's the ones where you type in, you know, maybe usually four digits. So you type four digits and then that's what opens the lock. Usually they're shared, so not every person has their own code, so it's kind of easy to get it from somebody in some way. They don't change the combination very often, so what happens is the numbers get worn down. So if it's a four-digit number, you know, that's only 10,000 possible combinations from 0 to 9999 if you were going to go and try to brute force attack it. But if I can see that there are four numbers that are worn down on this lock, I just really reduced the number of combinations that I have to try in a brute force attack. That's one, you know, it's another problem. They're easy to identify through shoulder surfing, so just watching somebody use the combination is another pretty easy bypass. Same for both kinds of combination locks. You could get really sophisticated and, you know, bring out like an infrared, whatever they call those things, where you can see the heat left behind. That's pretty high tech. That's getting almost Mission Impossible-ish. Most buildings, you don't have to go that crazy to get into them. So lack of accountability due to shared combinations, that's really common. Prolonged use and wear, because people don't change the combinations, so that happens pretty quickly. Brute force attack, eventually, I mean, it doesn't take too long to get through 10,000 combinations, and you're not going to probably have to get to 10,000 combinations. You'll start with 1, 2, 3, 4, 8, 6, 7, 5 is kind of a popular one, too. I don't know if you remember Tommy Two Tone. 8, 6, 7, 5, 3, 0, 9. Locks, mouths, being compromised, shoulder surfing, talked about all that stuff. So any questions at all? We don't mind seeing these things in certain places, like maybe you've got a layered approach to security, and this is just access to a storage room or something, you know, funky like that that we don't really need. You know, high security, but we wouldn't want to see this on any exterior doors really that lead into, you know, parts of the building. You usually don't want to see it, obviously, on data centers and not even wiring closets, if you can help it. Smart cards. So that's a smart card on the right. You can see the chip. The gold part is the integrated circuit. That's what makes it a smart card. Other types of cards have magnetic stripes, and those are pretty easy to compromise. When you do a magnetic stripe, it writes somewhere. You can, like the target attack, for instance, the attacker stole the entire magnetic stripe data. So what you can do with that is write that to any other mag stripe card. So even gift cards or whatever, and you can turn those into credit cards. So those are pretty easy to copy. Smart cards are more difficult. You've also got the proximity access cards, which is more RFID. Those are pretty easy to attack too. You just need to get an RFID reader and a circuit. And this is an attack that's kind of common. And you can carry that in a bag and then just walk by people with cards, and then you can create your own cards to bypass those. So any physical access control device, which is often used for electronic locks, credit card purchases, dual factor authentication, smart card has the circuit in it, can be contact or contactless. So a contactless card has to have some way to transmit its data, and usually that's radio frequency or RFID. That's a mag stripe card on the right. Not a lot of those. Those really aren't much, you know, in terms for access control. We don't see those all that often. The contact cards have to be inserted into a card reader. That's what you're doing now. If you shop at Target, now you got to put the card into the little thing, and then it makes that ugly noise when it's created the transaction. That's a contact card, so it has to be inserted into the reader. There are also contactless cards, which are read wirelessly. Usually those are RFID. RFID you can capture as an attacker. Like I said, you can capture RFID traffic, make your own card, and then compromise security. Magstripe, no circuits. Everything is written on the swipe itself. International cards are using smart cards. Now we're getting it here in the United States. Here's an example of a smart card and a mag card that are kind of combined into one. This is the common access card used by the Department of Defense. You can do kind of anything with this card, I think, within the Department of Defense. I don't work in the Department of Defense, but I'm pretty sure you can use this to access different parts of different facilities. Physical access control, dual factor authentication, digitally signed documents. I think you can even use it in, to purchase meals in the cafeteria. I mean, you can do kind of anything with this. Common access cards are also, cryptographic. So you've got, your own DOD's public key infrastructure tied into the card for just additional security and encryption. More of back to the digital signature piece. Better accountability. Tailgating, piggybacking. That's not the right kind of tailgating. It's not the right kind of piggybacking. But this is, really a very easy method to get into. So, for instance, in Minnesota, people are pretty nice here. It's pretty easy to sit in your car with a couple of cardboard boxes. You don't have to have anything in the cardboard boxes. Sit outside the facility, outside of an employee access door, and then when an employee starts walking up to the door, you grab your boxes and walk behind them, and they'll almost always open the door, hold the door open for you. People feel very uncomfortable about slamming doors in front of you. If you do the same kind of attack in New York City, they knock the boxes out of your hand and slam the door. So you have to take into account, culture when you're doing testing these types of things or doing attacks like this. I think in the book they talked about, standing outside the smoking area. That's a real common and easy way to attack as well. So you stand, outside waiting for. This works a lot better in blue collar, I think, environments where people do come out on a shift change, come out to smoke, and you're standing out there with them and you just strike up a conversation. Usually do some surveillance first, so you want to look like them and act like them, and then when they go back in, it's only one of them that badges, and then you piggyback or tailgate to get in. This is an easy attack method. So ideally, we would enforce that everybody needs to badge in if you have a badge access system. So even if the door is open, you still badge in so that we still have a record that everybody's badging in. You get everybody into that habit. So then if everybody's badging in and I'm the guy in between people that had never badged in, that could be an indication that I'm not authorized to be there. Easy. It's a simple attack. It really is. I was at a law firm downtown Minneapolis, and the key card access system, in the elevator lobby to get into the office space. And just to show you kind of how people operate, I was coming out of the office space and there were people getting off the elevator that wanted to get into the office space. Well, when I walked out, I closed the door behind me and the lawyer who wanted to get in called me an asshole because I closed the door behind me. But I'm not going to be the cause of the breach. So I took it and just whatever. People feel uncomfortable doing that. So you kind of have to be comfortable because it's not that I'm being rude. I'm playing by the rules. So it occurs when an unauthorized person follows an authorized person into the building. I think that's pretty easy. Policy should forbid employees from tailgating. A mitigating control here would be camera surveillance again. Guard access is nice. know, because then you can have guards, turnstiles are great mitigating controls. We'll talk about all that stuff. Yeah, it's easy to get into buildings. So this is something, you know, in your own security program. And it's pretty easy to audit, too. Just watch and see how many people are coming into the building. Now, if I go through the trouble of putting a keycard access system into on a door, and people are tailgating, every time they tailgate, they're defeating the control. So I don't know why I would put a control in place if people are purposely going to defeat it. But that's what happens in real life. Man traps and turnstiles. These are things that would be good preventative controls against, that would protect against piggybacking and tailgating. So man traps would come in all kinds of different shapes and forms. I'd authenticate with one door, it would open, and then it would have to close before I could authenticate with the second door. Usually it's a second form of authentication that would be wisest, and then that second door opens. So if I don't have both forms of authentication, then I won't get through the doors. Excuse me. There are man traps that I think are pretty cool, where they have weight. They detect the weight. So you get into the first door, it's logged that you are who you say you are. So it's going to compare your weight against the weight that's in the system. And if there's too big of a fluctuation, meaning that there's probably somebody else in with you, or maybe I have something that I'm bringing into the environment that I shouldn't, that would raise an alarm and it wouldn't open the second door. And then sometimes you would call a guard and a guard would have to let you in. So there's a lot of different ways you can do man traps. It really depends on what you're trying to protect. Man traps are generally a really good thing, certainly around data centers. Another thing is turnstiles. And so turnstiles come in all kinds of different shapes and sizes. Sometimes you have the gate kind of finger turnstiles that turn around and they're metal. A more common turnstile, like downtown and in office areas, is the ones that just sense people walking through. And if you didn't badge when you walked through, then it would issue an alarm. And yeah, so that's another type of turnstile. Yeah, no authentication for egress. But during an emergency, you certainly don't want to have anything prevent people from leaving as quickly as possible. Contraband checks. So when somebody enters a facility or leaves a facility, are they checked for contraband? So we do this every time we go in the airport, and we all enjoy that. Contraband, this is really popular in manufacturing, real popular like UPS. I don't know if anybody here has been to the UPS depot, but they're very strict about contraband checks because they don't want employees stealing packages, and they don't want people bringing things in that they shouldn't bring in. So contraband checks is a good best practice. People don't do it, and that's understandable because it usually doesn't fit the culture of the organization. But it is a good thing to have in policy that you kind of reserve the right to do spot checks or do contraband checks. It's a good good preventative and deterrent control. Motion detectors and perimeter alarms, they come in all kinds of different shapes and sizes. Ultrasonic microwave detectors basically send out a signal and they wait for a response. If the time fluctuates, then that's an indication that there was motion or something is in the way of the signal, and that would issue the alarm. Active sensors, because they do send out energy. Photoelectric, kind of like your garage door, is a photoelectric sensor, so it sends a beam. You have usually have a transmitter and a receiver, so and if something gets in between the beam, then that means that something's in the way of the beam, and it'll send an alarm. That one that's on the top there is actually also an infrared sensor, I think. But that's how those work. It's passive because it's a read-only device. I'm sorry. The photoelectric is not a passive sensor. The passive sensor would be the infrared device. Other perimeter alarms, door contacts on doors. So I don't know if you guys are like me, but every time I walk into a facility, I'm looking for stuff like that, even if I'm not actually being hired to do it. So looking for door contacts, usually that's an indicator that it's either alarmed or some kind of sensing that's going on the door. So it may not be an alarm. It might, in most cases it is an alarm, but it's something triggering something. So those sensors always kind of tip you off to something. This one here that you can see on the top picture, that's actually in a garage door. So you can see the garage door hinges. This one on the bottom is a pretty common type of sensor. It's magnetic, so if those two things come out of contact, then that breaks the circuit, which then sends the alarm. These are pretty common, so if you look in the door jams, usually in the top, you'll see one of these kind of in the door jam, and then you'll see one at the top of the door, and that's how those work. Pretty basic, but you know, certainly good things to have on the perimeter. You know, in the jams, will attack the weakest link. I guess it depends on what the attacker's, you know, motive is, but it's certainly a lot easier to go through a window than it is to go through a wall. It's easier to go through gypsum board than it is to go through bricks. So consider those weakest links in your own design of physical security. Do I have any mitigating controls around those weakest links? And again, it comes down to what, you know, really what your company does or what your organization does and what you have to protect. Hinges facing inward rather than outward. It's really easy to pop hinges. We've seen data centers where the hinges face outside and they're not even protected. So the protected would be a cap on it so that you can't drive the hinges out easily. And motion sensors in mail slots or don't include motion sensors. So one easy way to attack buildings that have, I don't know if you've ever seen those doors where they're locked, and then when you walk up to them, it's got a sensor on the top, and when you walk up to the door, it disengages the lock, so then you can leave. Those doors are really easy to defeat, too, because I can just take a coat hanger or whatever, but an easy way, just take a coat hanger with a little rag, shove it under the door, and just kind of wave it around, and then it'll disengage the door and you can get in. That's pretty easy. So look for things like that. And that's what it's talking about when it says doors with internal motion sensors should never include mail slots. Those types of motion sensors, but other types too, you get a lot of false alarms. External facing emergency doors should be marked for emergency use only and equipped with panic bars. And the panic bar should have an alarm. It's good to have those external doors, those emergency doors, not be ingress. So they're only egress doors. There's no way into the door. It's only an outside door. Glass windows, structurally weak. I learned my first time, I don't know, it was a few years ago. That was a lot of years ago. I was trying to break in, but I was hired to do it. And so I was just taking, I took a rock to a window, and the window was plexiglass. And I don't know if you've ever done that before, but the rock came back at me. I should have tested that first. The rock came back at me at like twice the speed, I think, of when it went at the window. That hurt. So just kind of a funny story, I guess. But windows are usually pretty easily, but you know, it's rare for windows to be broken in most of the attacks that we deal with because it leaves a lot of evidence. There's, it's an obvious that something bad happened. Most attackers, I think, depending on if it's just like a smash and grab, but most attackers like to go undetected, I think. But windows, look for things like what the windows are made out of, you know, if they're structurally strong. Certain places, it makes a lot of sense to have glass break alarms. So if a glass is broken, it should set an alarm. Security films, having the wire mesh in the windows. Again, it depends. Every window or every facility is a little bit different, but those are all things to consider. Walls around. Walls, structurally sound, obviously, in high, I'm not going to talk about seismic stuff and tornadoes and things like that, but we don't want a data center to usually be on an exterior wall. We don't normally want a data center to have windows that go exterior, that don't have exterior windows. Normally, we don't want data centers with windows at all. But the a data center on an exterior wall is sometimes a bad practice. A data center on an exterior wall without bollards is a better practice. A data center on an exterior wall that's just normal sheathing and things, it's not brick, is even worse. So consider these things when you're looking at the physical security of your facility or anybody's. Walls around secure areas, slab to slab, or sometimes we call it deck to deck. So in a data center, just putting a data center in a normal wall where you have a false ceiling, that's pretty easy to bypass. So the slab to slab would prevent against that. Raised floors are a good best practice because we run a bunch of things under those raised floors. It also kind of helps sometimes with heating and cooling. We put sensors under there for moisture. But if the raised floor goes to a door and I can get under the door through the area of the raised floor, that's also a problem. So walls protecting a secure perimeter do need to be physically secure, and we need to look for areas where we can bypass. So when we're doing assessments, we ask to push the false ceiling up on outside of the data center and even inside to see if you can potentially bypass or if it is truly slab to slab. Gypsum rock or sheetrock is really easy to bypass with just, you don't even need a sharp tool. You can just bust through it. So consider that. Walls should have a fire rating. In the case of most data centers, it should be 1 hour. Questions? Is this exciting yet? 807. We're doing all right. Guards. So guards are a good control. In the absence of guards, consider how near or close law enforcement is and the rounds that they make. So sometimes we can compensate for the absence of a guard with having close or nearby law enforcement. Dynamic control, certainly. It's a preventative control. It's a detective control. It's a corrective control. It's a deterrent control. It's a number of different controls are guards. They can be used to, obviously monitor environmentals, make building rounds. If they're making building rounds, we don't want them making building rounds in any kind of a repeatable pattern. We want them to make random building rounds. Random in terms of timing and random in terms of what areas they visit in what order. But guards can be used. Back in college, I was a guard at, used to be the Pillsbury Center. Now I can't remember what the name of the building is now. But we used to respond to a lot of incidents. We had a lot of intoxicated people doing things. So guards help with all that good stuff. Professional guards have advanced training and schooling. Amateur guards, all cops, don't. Pseudo guard means an unarmed guard. In some cases, it makes sense to have an armed guard. Guards need to be, in most cases, need to be fairly well trained. They can cause an untrained guard can cause more, usually can sometimes cause more damage than not having a guard at all. Because if one of the guards responds in a way that's inappropriate, that might bring liability to me. Guards, if they're not trained well, are pretty easily easily socially engineered. So a lot of training for guards. Dogs. It's rare to see dogs because there is so much liability in having dogs, because if a dog bites somebody, causes damage, even if it's all, even if somebody really was trying to break in, nowadays, you can still be liable if the dog bites them. Dogs have been trained to not attack. Dogs like this are trained to not attack if you stop, but if you keep going, the dog will. Usually they're trained to bite you. So using control areas, usually use them in kind of the DMZ, the exterior or the perimeter. So you have an exterior gate, and then you have the perimeter wall, and the dogs kind of roam in between that area. Deterrent and detective controls. Yeah, I mean, most, I don't recall seeing dogs for a long time other than in like those impound lots, maybe things like, you know, places like that. I guess you kind of still see dogs, but not really in commercial settings anymore. Deterrent, detective, liability is a bad thing. So site design, selection design, and configuration. So at the very beginning of determining, I mean, if you have the opportunity of determining where you're going to place your site, that's obviously ideal. So that you, and it's called a greenfield process. So where are we going to put our site? Taking things like, you know, putting it in a wooded area, putting it, you know, on, which is typically a bad thing because that gives a lot of, we have line of sight issues. It's easy for attackers to hide. So, you know, putting it in a field where it's flat is kind of nice because I have line of sight. So if I put camera surveillance or I have people, it's easier to detect something coming. And it's also harder to attack a site like that. Putting it into a mountain or a hill. I was at the, not too many years ago, I was at the First Data Center, which is built into a hill. That's their part of their site design. So during the site selection process, if you have an opportunity to do that, I think that the point for the exam is that security should be really considered as part of the site selection process. And what greenfield means. Greenfield just means that there's nothing there. Topography plays a big role in our physical security approach. Hills, valleys, trees, etc. So if the purpose is to not be seen, then maybe a tree lot isn't a bad idea. But usually it's not a good idea for data centers. Obviously military installations sometimes will leverage. The topography is a defensive measure. They'll build it into a mountain. Like I said, the First Data Center was built into a hill. They don't really have mountains in, I think it was Omaha. That's all I have is hills. They don't have mountains. Consider how you're going to, are you going to use the topography? And I mentioned berms before, building berms or, you know, using the natural flow of the land to control ingress and egress points. Those are all things to consider. Talking about the topography, where you're going to put your, or assessing, obviously. Utility reliability. Some places have a lot more power outages than other places. I did the Experian data center in Manhattan, New York, right across from the Bull. They have power outages and fluctuations all the time. So it was really important for them to ensure that they had the proper power conditioning. They had UPSs and generators. So consider that in your strategy for physical security. How reliable? It's not uncommon to design a site with two power feeds from two different power grids. You know, sometimes there's a call for that. Also, where power comes into the facility, it's usually not a good thing to also have your telco come in the same route. Those are all just notes. Crime. Crime has a huge impact on the types of physical controls that we're going to employ, as well as certainly safety. the physical controls that we would employ in a site in, you know, southeast Minneapolis or south Minneapolis would be a lot different than the site controls that we would choose, you know, in Faribault or even here in Rochester. So because there are so many different factors that come into play, and that was one of the challenges, that's always one of the challenges in assessing physical security. We have to take into account crime rates. The best data that we usually have for crime rates is what's been reported to the FBI, and the FBI produces these reports, and then we try to figure it out from there. So local crime rates, huge, have a huge impact on the type of controls and what we're going to do for site selection and employee safety, obviously. So a lot of different places you can get crime data, but it all kind of ties back to the FBI. And another challenge with crime data is we're reliant on the police department, the local police department, and what they report. Some local police departments are a lot better at reporting crimes than others, so sometimes you get an artificial inflation or deflation in the crime rate. That's hard to find and detect sometimes. So site design cannot compensate for poor site selection. So if you've chosen a poor physical site where you're going to build or where you have your data center, there's only so much you can do on the design side to compensate for it, but it can't fully compensate. It's like when we were talking about, you know, if I have an insecure kernel or something that, you know, in the operating system, if the core of something is insecure, the rest is going to be affected by that. So site marking, we typically don't like. Not only the building itself, so if this is a data center, it could be a shared data center. Not only do we want not it, we do want not it. We don't want to advertise that this is a data center. So not just externally, but also internally. So when you walk around a facility and you've got this door that's locked and then you've got a placard on the side of the wall that says data center, you know, that's also something to consider. So not just site marking externally, but site marking internally is important. Even though I don't subscribe to the security through obscurity, this is kind of important because I'm really calling attention to the fact that I've got some sensitive information here. So it kind of plays that way. There's a lot of data centers that I know of that people, big data centers, that I would have never guessed that there was a data center there. They did a really good job of kind of masking it. And then in the book, there's the example of Netflix, like the U.S. Bank data center. It's very nondiscreet. The Wells Fargo data center, really nondiscreet. UHG's data center, really nondiscreet. Those are all data centers I've seen before. The first data center was pretty obvious that there was something really important there because you have a bunch of guards and such everywhere, but you can only do so much. Shared tenancy. This is a big deal. Where my facility is located alongside or within the same building as other tenants or other parts, other organizations. Not only is there the possibility that the lack of security controls of one of the other tenants can affect my security, of my organization, it's also some of the tenants might do business that's a little more sensitive than the type of business I do. So they might be targeted, whereas I'm not normally targeted, but if they're going to target them, that affects my security as well. So that can be an issue that you certainly need to consider. So not only their poor security controls affecting my poor security controls, but the type of business that they are can affect my security controls as well. So I need to take those things into consideration on how I'm going to build my own preventative controls. And not just that, neighboring premises too. You know, if there's a government building across the street or a federal courthouse, you know, across the street from my building, I need to take that into consideration. Or if there's an airport, you know, obviously that plays a role too. So those are all things to think about with shared tenancy in adjacent buildings that affect my security. Shared DMARC. So in any one of the buildings, just about every one of the buildings downtown Minneapolis or any big city, there's a shared DMARC. It's usually in the basement, not too far from the shipping and receiving docks. I mean, usually there's some hallways that go back, and somewhere there's a DMARC that's shared by numerous organizations. In rare cases, there may be a DMARC that's shared by every organization building. The security of those things need to be really well controlled. In a lot of cases, who controls access to those places might be the building security or what have you. But those things need to be considered. You might have the opportunity in a shared DMARC location to put a secure cabinet or some other type of method of securing yours versus somebody else's. So segregating those DMARCs is definitely a good idea. But something to consider. I think a lot of people don't consider that. Because here I've got all my network traffic, basically inbound, outbound, going through this room. And I'm sharing that room with a bunch of people that might, they can easily access my equipment or my data potentially. But they can also, if they're not well skilled, and I mean, I've seen times when somebody's run a cart into another company's or you know their equipment and took their equipment offline, didn't even realize they did it, and then went about you know their way, and it took the company quite a while and it cost them a lot of money to fix that. System defenses, last line of defense, defense in depth strategy, asset tracking, port controls. So assuming that the attacker has access to the device or media containing sensitive information, things like encryption, encrypting data, asset tracking, most organizations, I mean, it's kind of scary, but organizations really do a poor job of asset tracking, even physical asset tracking. So something to consider. It doesn't really matter. I mean, sometimes I can have the greatest physical security controls ever, but if I don't control anybody taking things out of the facility that I have no idea really what I have, it kind of defeats a lot of the controls that I built. Port controls are certainly a big deal. Not just port controls for the computer system itself, like USB, you know, locking out USB drives. And I think we all know what USB drives and, you know, understand not only the security problems that they bring into the environment. A really easy way to attack an organization is to, I don't even know if I should, well, you could think of these things, but, you know, go to a conference and, you know, hand out flash drives and tell them, you know, that this is you know, this is a copy of my presentation and it's really cool and, you know, you should really get, you know, you should really take a look at this thing. And on that flash drive, I've got, you know, a virus. And I've tested that virus. So people are taking these flash drives, go to a hospital conference because they're plugging it into their computers. And obviously, if I'm an attacker, I've tested it against all the common antivirus you know, manufacturers. And it takes typically about 30 days for antivirus. Yeah, isn't that how? Yeah, that is how the Israelis got into the nuclear reactor in Iran. It's just so simple, and people don't think about it. And I think a lot of times people think of USB and flash drives as data exfiltration, so, you know, data leaving the organization, but just as damaging is if somebody brings something into the organization through a USB drive. So whatever, small enough to evade, you know, contraband checks. So certainly having port controls in place to prevent that. And it can be, I mean, as drastic as, you know, I know some government agencies actually put super glue in the USB drives. Other organizations, you know, buy software to restrict access to those things. But even when they restrict access to those things, what I've seen most organizations do is if you're going to write data to it, then it's going to encrypt it. Well, it still doesn't stop the stuff coming in, so whatever. Definitely something to think about. Drive and tape encryption. After all these breaches, you know, truly, I don't know how many breaches we've had where tapes have been lost or stolen, or laptops have been lost or stolen, and they were not encrypted. It's crazy, but still happens. So tapes are going off-site, unencrypted. Sometimes we have tapes that are being, you know, they're not using even a strong or a solid courier to move tapes from location to location. I guess you do so at your own peril. There's been a lot of breaches, a lot of liability for those things. The good thing about encryption is if I do lose a drive or a tape that's been encrypted, I have safe harbor in a lot of data breach notification laws, and I have safe harbor from, you know, HIPAA. So, yeah, it's a good thing. Whole disk encryption for mobile device hard drives is recommended with pre-boot authentication. They all have pre-boot authentication pretty much now, but you used to be able to bypass the authentication. So even if the drive was encrypted, you could bypass it if you don't have pre-boot authentication built in, built into hardware or software. We have TPM chips on this laptop, so it's a hardware encryption. Yeah, so drive and tape encryption, certainly things to, does safe harbor apply to any encryption or does it have to meet specific requirements? Most of them don't get that detail. They just say encrypted, strong encryption is what they'll say. Media storage and transportation, so taking data offsite, not only do we have to be take into account the protection of the data, but we also need to take into account, protection of confidentiality of the data. We also need to take into account the availability of the data. So storing the data in a location that is environmentally sound, having procedures so that we can track this media going offsite. You could also, obviously transfer back. But if we're taking physical media offsite, we do have to have some really strict procedures and accounting. So when the courier comes, they should be authenticated. They should show ID, hopefully corporate company ID from the organization. And it's the same person that's been there before. So they've got a checkoff with an authorized list of people who can pick up the media. It's in a locked box or container. You know, the procedure is to go from here to here. So, you know, there's a certain only out for a certain amount of time before it gets to the secure facility. I mean, just all those things are really kind of important and not often considered. And often they are, but things that should be considered. Bonded, insured company. Bonding and insurance doesn't really help you all that much if there's a breach. So if I haven't encrypted my tapes or my drives, and this bonded and insured company lost my media, my reputation's already smashed, and I'm still going to have liability. I might be able to recover some from the company, but so I guess what I'm saying there is that's a good mitigating control, but it's not a primary control. It doesn't compensate fully for the lack of other controls. Never used informal practices. I actually was just talking to an organization not all that long ago, and I'm not going to name who it is. Their backup tapes are stored, and this is super uncommon, but their backup tapes are stored in a fire safe in the data center. That's, it doesn't protect, obviously, against a physical destruction of the data center. You won't be able to recover your data anywhere else. But then they said in order to take data offsite, one of the IT staff takes the drive and puts it in his computer bag and carries it with him. And then that's their rotation. Probably not good. Media cleaning and destruction. We've talked a little bit about this before, but all forms of media should be cleaned and destroyed before disposal. We talked about D-band. We talked about, you know, AT secure erase for SSD drives. We talked about all those things. Those are important things to be done, obviously. Physical or electronic. Dumpster diving is a really easy attack. I don't know if I told you guys about the story of my dumpster diving. If I didn't, I'll tell you some other time. But I've had lots of dumpster diving fun. You'll be amazed at what you find in dumpster diving. You'll be amazed at what you find in walking around the facility, your own facility, and looking through the garbage. It's not a glamorous job, but people throw away a lot of things they shouldn't throw away. And you'd be amazed at what people put in recycle bins instead of the secure shred bins. There's a lot of good data there, too, in most cases. So cleaning destruction actions, we should have formal policies. Everything we do in information security should be tied somewhere in policy. That's our authorization from management to do what we do. All the activities should be documented, serial numbers. In an ideal situation, our data destruction practices would be fully auditable. So, you know, I would have a record of every hard drive that was destroyed, when it was destroyed, how it was destroyed, and the validation that it was destroyed. I would have a fully auditable data destruction practice so that if it comes to our attention that a hard drive may have been lost or stolen, that's one place where I can validate if that's true or not. This becomes a lot bigger deal if people report the hard drive on eBay or whatever. They should be fully auditable. Environmental controls. Power HVAC. You don't need to know, for the exam, you don't need to know how to design an HVAC system or how to design a data center. That's an entire practice by itself. But the basics about, you know, power fluctuations, you know, brownouts, blackouts, those things, and HVAC and fire safety. So these basics are really what you need to know for the exam. Electricity is the number one thing. The number one failed physical security control or failed thing. It leads to availability problems. Power is still pretty, in most places, it's not totally reliable. So how do I feel about some of the cloud backup options available, like Carbonite? What type of encryption do they use? Carbonite used to use, I think, 128-bit AES. They may have changed since then. I think those are online cloud backup options, and in a lot of cases, are actually, I think, more safe than physical backups because, one, I don't have to worry about tape deterioration. I don't have to worry about physical. Because anytime I put people, it seems like anytime I put people into the mix, the more prominent role they play, the more security problems I have. So when I do an online backup solution, there's no person involved in taking the tapes, putting them, you know, wherever the pickup place is, and then having the courier come and pick up the tapes. So there's just a lot less steps and complexity involved, and I think less people, which is a good thing. So I'm kind of a pretty big proponent of cloud backup options. You still need to do your due diligence, but yeah. And your DRP would, you know, obviously have to change a little bit to account for the new backup. All right, so electricity, bad, not bad, good, but can go bad a lot. So when I'm selecting a site, I mean, check with the do your research and find out if electricity is pretty solid there. And you probably won't be able to get that data from the electric utility, but you might be able to get it from neighbors, in the area. So you'll have to memorize this. You'll have to memorize blackout, brownout, fault surge, spike, and sag. Those are going to be things that are probably going to be on the test. So blackout, prolonged loss of power, brownout, prolonged low voltage. Fault, short loss of power, surge, prolonged high voltage, spike, temporary high voltage, and sag, temporary low voltage. So, yeah, memorize that. These are faults. They obviously impact availability, but they can also impact integrity. If you know, the system is in the middle of a write process, you know, it's potential that we could have, you know, file or data loss. Oh, this is a small, I should have made this one bigger. But surge protectors, UPSs, and generators, they provide protection against electric failures and fluctuations and those things. Surge protectors protect against electrical surges. They have a circuit or a fuse that gets tripped when there's a spike or a surge, which shorts the power and regulates it to an acceptable level. So that's a power conditioning function. Uninterruptible power supplies, or UPSs, do the clean power. So they protect against surges, spikes, and other forms of electrical faults, whereas surge protectors is usually just spikes and surges. Temporary backup power. When we're doing assessments, we're usually looking for how long can a UPS sustain power at full load, assuming that power goes out. Obviously, that time, if you have a generator, needs to be sufficient enough to where the generator can kick in. And there's different types of switches for the generator. Most of them are automatic transfer switches, which means that the power switches automatically. But we still do run into occasionally where there's a manual transfer switch. So I don't know why you'd replace that, but we still do see it. So that means that you have the UPS, power kicks on. There needs to be some type of an alert so I can call somebody and give them enough time to come in and switch the power. If I don't have a generator at all, ideally there's enough time in the UPS to alert somebody and have them power down the systems in a orderly fashion, starting with critical assets. But backup power for UPSs is really batteries or fuel cells. There's flywheels. There's all kinds of other things now. But for the test, it's batteries or fuel cells. Limited amount of time, and we need to make sure that it's long enough to get the generator online. Generators, long periods of time, sometimes days, weeks, months. For a generator, the big thing about generators, we need to make sure they have fuel supply. There's different types of generators, diesel generators, where there's a belly tank usually. So we need to make sure that belly tank has fuel that's sufficient enough to where I can get my next delivery. And where I fall on the delivery schedule. It's not a bad idea in critical operations to have multiple fuel contracts with multiple suppliers. Just something to consider. Places like government buildings, hospitals, places like that will get precedent over you, usually, with fuel contracts. Other types of fuel, though, where I may not need a fuel contract would be natural gas generator. Natural gas generators, though, I need to consider the fuel lines. I mean, if it's a seismic event or something happens that disrupts the fuel line, then what? So, considering those things in your disaster recovery plan, there's different types of generators to cover different things. Should definitely be tested and serviced regularly. Most people do that pretty well. So natural gas is definitely a legitimate type of generator, even a gas generator is better than no generator. So even running to Menards, Home Depot, whatever your home, whatever store is, those generators are better. You know, the gas ones are better than nothing. EMI. So EMI, I think we may have talked about before, but when we're talking about Tempest, EMI is interference that comes from magnetism. So electricity, as it runs across copper, creates a magnetism. One of the hardest times I've ever had to troubleshoot anything, I started as a network guy back in the early 90s, and one of the most difficult time-consuming network faults that I needed to troubleshoot, and this was on an old token ring network, and we'll talk about token ring in a few classes, it was intermittent. What would happen was the entire network would go down because token ring, you know, used a multi-station access unit, it's called. But basically, logically, it's a ring. If there's a break in the ring, the network goes down. And so, I don't know, 8, 9, 10 times a day, the network would go down at intermittent times. There was no pattern to it. There was nothing logged about it. In the logs, there was just nothing to really tell us what the heck was going on. Well, it turned out, and it took us over a week to figure this out. Every time the women's restroom light was turned on, the network would go down. And what was happening is we had the cable running, and the shielding was really bad back then. We had the cabling running over fluorescent lights. And so every time we turn the light on, network down. You leave, turn the light off, network back up. So it was really difficult to do that. Yeah. It was a bad day, bad week. ABC UPS systems for data centers will have N plus one, usually redundant with hot swappable batteries. Yeah, and N plus one, N meaning this is what I need to run, and then plus one means, you know, that added redundancy. Yeah. And I don't know if you'll have to know N plus one for or too much about data center design for the exam, but it's good stuff to know. So crosstalk. Crosstalk is when you have, you know, MI interference from one cable to another. And I don't know if you've talked, you don't get this anymore, but you used to be on analog phones, you'd talk on the phone and you'd hear somebody else's conversation. That was an example of crosstalk. All right. So HVAC, keeping air and temperature. So the big things to remember about HVAC for the purpose of the exam is temperature, humidity, and air quality. Those are the three big things about HVAC systems. Operating in a closed loop, there's all kinds of different HVAC system designs now where we don't. There are legitimate HVAC systems where it's not closed loop. There's legitimate HVAC units where they pump in outside air in a cool environment to cool. Just what we're talking about here for the purpose of the exam is a closed loop, recirculating treated air, keeping dust out and airborne particles. There's VESDA units, which I don't think you'll see in the exam, but that's for very early smoke detection apparatus. VESDA, when you go in a data center, you see those orange pipes that are just kind of open. Those are usually VESDA units. So if you do see it on the exam, that's what those are. All HVAC units should apply positive pressure. Positive pressure means that, and I don't know if you ever went to the Metrodome. It's gone now, but when you walk through the non-turning doors, you open the other doors and it like push you out. That's positive pressure. So positive pressure pushes contaminants out. If there's a leak or something bad, it pushes it out rather than sucking it in. So HVAC units should operate that way. Air, water, contaminants expelled from the building as opposed to bringing it into the building. Malfunction in HVAC units, certainly water pooling because, you know, there's condensate, which is what the water is, pooling into the building. It's not uncommon to see HVAC units, you know, in the ceiling that don't have that have dripped onto equipment before and broken things, often under raised floors, positive drains, whatever. So will we have to know chilled water systems? Probably not. I doubt you'll have to know chilled water systems for the test. I didn't actually read this portion of the book, so if you see chilled water in the book, then I would assume it would be in the test. But if it's not in the book, it won't be in the test. Because the guys who wrote this book are really kind of dead on. Location, gas, water lines, drains shall be formally documented. Obviously, humidity levels between 40 and 55% is what's recommended. If we have too much humidity, what we get is corrosion. If we don't have enough humidity, we end up getting static. That's in general. So too much humidity, corrosion, not enough humidity, static, set point temperature. These things should all be monitored as well. You don't need to know you probably will need to know temperature range 68 to 77. You probably need to know 40 to 55% for, I don't think you'll need to know the green. But this is probably a slide that you'll have to memorize. Static and corrosion. So static discharge this used to be a much bigger problem back in the day. It's not quite as big of a problem today. We used to have static mats in data centers so that, you know, you'd have to strap yourself to it so then it wouldn't, when I touch something, my static electricity wouldn't blow out the chip. But still, they're susceptible to problems. So if things get too dry, you can destroy chips, computer equipment. Grounding. You can ground yourself. And that would be the strap. I don't know if you've ever seen that before, but the strap and the mat would be grounding so that when you touch something, you're not going to static it out. Racks are grounded. Very difficult to touch equipment without touching the rack and grounding out. True. High humidity levels, corrosion. So for the test, know what static is, know what corrosion is, know where it comes from. You're good. Airborne contaminants. This is why we don't like people bringing unboxing servers in data centers generally. When you tear open a box, there's a bunch of airborne contaminants, and a lot of it you can't see, some of it you can. Those dust particles can gum up all kinds of stuff, certainly your computer enclosures. In a computer system, you only have a few moving parts, and those moving parts are the ones that are most susceptible to failure. So hard drives and fans. When fans get gummed up, you have heat problems. So dust is a big deal in data centers and server rooms. Keep it clean, I guess. Heat, flame, and smoke detectors, three ways to detect fire: heat, flame, and smoke. Heat is, flame requires point of sight. Smoke and heat do not. Heat detectors exceeds a certain baseline, and you can set the system to whatever baseline that is. Usually it's a few hundred degrees, and it depends on where your heat detector is. If it's a ceiling-mounted heat unit, which makes the most sense, it would trigger. And its triggering can do any number of things. It can also be set to a baseline of exceeding certain numbers in a certain amount of time. But heat detectors would just be managing or monitoring heat, just like a temperature, a thermometer, really. Smoke detectors, ionization and photoelectric. So ionization would be looking for the radioactive source, looking for the static charge in the air. Photoelectric sensors work kind of the same way, but with an LED. Flame detectors use ultraviolet light, they're detecting infrared and ultraviolet light, so it requires a line of sight for the flame detectors. Different types of monitoring flame detection. Safety and awareness is a big deal. So safety, training people, having the placards on the walls of how to escape the building, running through drills, having evacuation routes posted, usually by stairwells and maybe by elevators. People shouldn't be using elevators in the case of a fire, obviously. Maybe not obviously. I suppose people still try to. And guests. So one of the things we don't see very often is visitors being briefed at all on any of the emergency procedures, because it just seems like it's an inconvenience and whatever. It's a good idea to actually brief your visitors on this is just kind of our safety procedures. All sites should have a meeting point. So if there is a need to evacuate, where are people going to meet? And that should be part of your drill. You may have a warden who kind of, drives that. So two primary evacuation roles, the safety warden and the meeting point leader. The safety warden makes sure everybody gets out of the building. The meeting point leader takes an accounting of everybody who met at the meeting point. they work together and they work in tandem. Obviously, personnel with handicaps need to be treated a little bit different. We need to make sure that they can get out as well. Don't use elevators, mitigating controls. Mitigating controls, safe egress for all personnel, having multiple. Now, this is usually fairly easy to design in a building because it's going to be in code. It's going to be in your building codes. It's going to be your fire marshal is going to have specific requirements in terms of how the site is designed and can certainly help you build the evacuation plan. Different fire suppression. So you'll need to know A, B, C, D, and K. A is wood, put out with fire, dry powder. B is flammable liquids. C is electrical fire. And then D is combustible. So for instance, today, as we were walking through the facility, in their server room, they had a BC fire extinguisher. So it's marked prominently on fire extinguishers what type of suppression they do. You'll need to memorize that table. So you'll need to know that fire classification of A, wood, cloth, these are carbon combustibles. Water, dry powder, halon are things that you can use to put that out. And you'll see on the fire extinguisher itself, the triangle. That's a universal symbol. Local PD is cautioned against mass meeting points, specifically during, very good point. So one of the private comments was, local PD is cautioned against mass meeting points, specifically during active shooter events. And you won't see active shooter events, I don't think, on the exam, but that's certainly something to count for nowadays in real life that, honestly, I don't ever really count for. There is an active shooter event. You know, you don't want everybody congregating in one spot. That's a good point. And then class K is for kitchen fires. So you'll need to memorize this one. This is another one of those memorize ones. We got 8 minutes. So different fire code for implementing a fire suppression system. That's what they're there for. They certainly, you know, like helping on those things, meaning the fire department. Four different methods. We can either reduce the temperature, reduce the oxygen, reduce the fuel, and interfere with the chemical reaction. That's how fire suppression works. Water is the most common fire suppression, usually the safest fire suppression agent. Lowering temperature, it also does, you know, take away some of the fuel. Safest of the suppression agents. Doesn't work on electrical, obviously. So if you're going to, be careful around electricity. Soda acids, I don't know if you remember those old-fashioned brass fire extinguishers, that would be soda acid. Work by lowering the temperature. Also messes a little bit, I think, with the chemical reaction. Dry powder, sodium chloride. So that's the one you see when you see people. This is a very common one. If you've seen fire drills before and they spray it, it's all white stuff. That's the dry powder. Lowers the temperature, smothers the fire, keeps the oxygen. Can be used for metal fires. Dry powder. Wet chemical. Used to extinguish kitchen fires. This would be a type K. Also A's, type A combustible fires. CO2. CO2 is kind of dangerous because CO2 steals the oxygen from the air and can kill you. Usually you see CO2 in like remote unmanned areas, you know, because it is very effective at putting out the fire, but obviously you don't want to do this in any place where there's people. But it's very effective. Halon and halon substitutes. So halon has been phased out, the Montreal Accord in 1989, because it kills the ozone layer. So you don't see halon anymore. You can probably still get some, I think. But most places have replaced their halon systems with other things. These are the substitutes. Argon FE, FM200 is probably I think one of the most common that I see, it's the red tanks that you see in data centers with the funky looking brass covers in the ceilings. FM200 Intergen. So these are the things that you could use to replace your old Halon system, and they'll be the ones on the test. Countdown timers. Countdown timers give me enough time to get out or deactivate the fire suppression before it actually is going to go. Almost like if your FM200 system goes out, it's not going to kill you, but it's expensive to have that recharged. So, you know, it's good to have the countdown timer. So it gives you an opportunity to, one, get out and evacuate, or two, respond and see if it actually is a fire, if there's a malfunction in the system, so you can deactivate it before it goes off. Fire, and actually water is the most, today is the most common still. Pre-action dry pipe is the most common data center fire suppression. Not just data centers, but data centers / server rooms. So all sprinkler systems, fire alarm, so an audible alarm as well as a blinking or some kind of visual alarm for people that can't hear well. Evacuation obviously is number one, get people out. Wet pipes means that there's a valve, so the pipe itself is wet all the way to the valve, and once the valve is opened, water comes out. There's no time for the pipes to fill, nothing like that. It's just out there. Now, this wouldn't work very well in places where there's extreme cold, like a parking garage, for instance, because you'll burst the pipe. What holds it back is that you'll see the small glass bulb. It either melts or breaks, and that's what releases the valve and lets the water come out. These are the temperatures. So when you look in the valve of a sprinkler head, that's the temperature of which it will melt and trigger the water. Seems like red is the kind of the prevailing one, 155 degrees, and then water comes. There's the standard there. So wet pipe, dry pipe means that there's nothing in the pipes. It's just filled with compressed air. When something happens, the compressed air shoots out. So you do this, and then water comes right after that. So dry pipes are good in places where things might freeze, because there's not going to burst your pipe. Deluge pipes work kind of the same way, but they're larger. So when you look at the sprinkler head, it's a pretty fat, big sprinkler head, and it's meant to deluge, just dump as much water on a location as quickly as possible. Deluge systems. Pre-action, so pre-action means something has to happen before something else happens. Two separate triggers to release the water. So the first one would be essentially letting the air out, and then the next one would be filling the pipe. So it gives you a little bit of extra time to deactivate the fire suppression before we potentially destroy the equipment or, in this case, museums, artwork, whatever. Fire extinguishers. So look at your fire extinguishers. It's kind of cool because now that you kind of know what the letters mean, maybe you already did know, it's kind of cool to look at fire extinguishers now and know, is this the right fire extinguisher for the application? You can quiz your friends too, I guess. So they'll be marked with the type of, you should practice. Not necessarily practice, but if you've never used one before, it's not a bad idea to have a few people learn how to operate a fire extinguisher. And then the pass method, pull the pin, aim low. So you aim at the base of the fire, squeeze the pin and sweep it. The pass method. All right, we're at good timing, right about 9 o'clock. Domain 4 is going to be fun. I'll be back in back in the office, so that'll be cool, because I really like being back at the office more. I love the interaction. So if you get an opportunity to be back at the office or be at the FRSecure offices, Tuesday. I will be teaching from there. We're going to hit right into network architecture and design. This is also one of my favorite domains, along with cryptography. This is a fun one. We're going to get pretty technical, but not too technical. We don't have to be experts on all these things. But like I said, the whole purpose of the CISSP exam is that mile wide, 2 inches deep kind of thing. So we're not going to go too deep in the latest and greatest network access control, IPS stuff or anything like that, but we are going to need to know the basics. So this is what we're going to cover next week. We'll probably get all the way through network architecture design and get somewhere into the devices and protocols. So domain three, we're done. Quizzes are coming. I promise I will get those out tomorrow sometime, one for encryption and one for this domain. Read chapter four if you can. It's not homework for Thursday, though, because we are Thursday right now, so it'll be Tuesday. That's it. So hopefully this was helpful. Hopefully this was better than last Thursday. It's tough teaching from hotels. Anyway, I appreciate everybody. I hope you guys all have a great weekend. I'll send you the slides and everything. Take care.